I'm going to argue today that we're doing the same thing with boys. We are projecting onto young boys some ideas about who they are that actually hurt boys and do damage to their self-concept and influence their trajectories educationally, athletically, and in every fundamental way. So, what we know is that children look at who they are as we project reflections to them. They look at their mom's eyes, her face, her attitude, and they absorb who they are in that experience. You are signaling to your son in every imaginable way who you think they are, and children are vulnerable to absorbing those messages. You know, they're always asking the question, who am I and what can I do? And where they're going to draw their information as they build those self-concepts is in relationships with significant people, people that matter to them. And the people who matter most immediately to them are you. How you regard your son, how well you align yourself with his needs, what kinds of possibilities you can imagine in your own mind for him, that's the kind of information that he's going to absorb as he builds a sense of self. There's a problem. And the problem is that we're not very accurate reflectors. I'm holding my grandson, and I'm reflecting back to him things that have nothing to do with him, things that come from places in my own experience, maybe my experience with my dad, which was wonderful, but, you know, I didn't do my son that way, and I won't do my grandson that way. We're learning more and more and more about who boys really are. And we're in this wonderful period where we almost get to reinvent boyhood in a more, in a cleaner way, a way less tainted with stereotype. A colleague at Stanford University, her name is Judy Chu, did a 2-year study. She followed 4-year-old boys for 2 years, observed them in class, interviewed them, met with their parents, and she just recently wrote a book called When Boys Became Boys. And what she found was that the boys at 4 years old, they were very expressive. They were very authentic. They were very present in their relationships as themselves. 2 years later, absorbing the messages that they received in school and home, they had become more masked. More restrained. She says, Judy Chu, they traveled from presence to posturing via pretense. They learned to put on a mask and to pretend to be something that didn't really match who they were inside. They learned to fit in to the masculinity curriculum that they encountered everywhere in their lives, including school, and including from people that really loved them and were trying to do well by them. They became boys in a socially acceptable way. We all have to do that. We all want to fit in. We want to get along. The problem for boys, if we don't fit in, is sometimes serious. You know, the policing of boys that don't conform in basic ways, the peer policing can be brutal, harsh, hurtful. And every boy can tell you a story. I could ask you guys here, the men here, to raise your hands. I could ask the question, how many of you have witnessed or experienced violence? And every guy would raise his hand. We know what happens, you know, what can happen if you're male. And you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, or you're sending the wrong signals. So guys, understandably, learn to fit in. The problem is, as Judy Chu found in her research at 6 years old, that inauthenticity robs boys of the experience being real, naming, expressing what's in their hearts, finding ways to connect with other people around who I really am and what I really need. From presence to posturing via pretense. So what I want to talk to you today about, what I'm sort of talking to parents about, is how we can strengthen boys to resist this masculinity curriculum that inhabits all of their relationships. You know, we can work it at the other end. We can work it in schools, as I was doing last week. You know, we can help teachers, coaches, others, mentors. We can help them get a better understanding of how they are relating to boys. But we can work it more directly with boys themselves. We can actually, in our relationship with boys, we can help them identify who they really are, what they really think, what they really feel, and find ways to resist the pressure to conform, to submit, and be themselves. So I want to talk about a set of virtues, character strengths that I think are particularly relevant for males, and some strategies that we parents can employ to strengthen those virtues in boys so that they might better resist the pressure to conform. Does that make sense? The first one is authenticity. Being yourself. Why does that matter? Because if you're not present as who you really are, if you've gone behind the mask and you simply learn to get by pretending to be what other people want you to be, you lose the immediacy of your experience. You're no longer living your life from your heart out, from your mind out. And there's a term, a psychiatrist, Sandra Bloom, and I wrote a book called Bearing Witness, but we used the term, actually her term, robopathology. We become like robots, you know, walking like a zombie through our lives, just kind of fitting in here, there, and everywhere. And we lose touch with our core experience. Another fancy term that a psychologist has used to characterize males' emotional facility is alexithymia. Very fancy word, no words for feeling what it means. We lose our vocabulary to describe our own experience if every day is simply, in a zombie-like way, you know, negotiating our relationships on the basis of what people want. So, what can parents do to help their sons strengthen the virtue of authenticity? It's really simple. It's simple and incredibly, incredibly challenging. But y'all have heard the term special time. We mostly think of special time as a parenting tool that we use with young children. You know, we get down on the rug and we play blocks or we play trains. Well, I actually think that there's no end to how well that tool can be used with younger people. And special time with an adolescent, these boys that I met with, the ones in the hallway there, it simply looks like this. You carve out a block of time and you go and you sit next to them. I don't care where you are or what they're doing, and you simply muster interest in who they are and what they're doing. Whatever it might be, it's not yours to control. It's their time. They get to take you where they want to go. And if you can stick it out with them, if you can hang in with them, and if you can do that on a regular basis, once a week, 1 hour once a week, you come into their room, you sit in front of the TV, you play their darn video games. I hate video games. that was almost torture for me, because I always wanted to win and I never could. You know, you play whatever sport they like to play. You know, you take off the catcher's mitt and receive the pitches, or you throw the football, or shoot the basketball, or whatever it might be. One of my sons had a period of time in which he liked to wrestle. Oh my God. I actually found myself in a father-son wrestling camp. I'd never wrestled in my life, and they matched me with a guy 20 years younger who had actually been a college wrestler. You know, I'm going to wrestle. But you know, my son loved that I evidenced some interest in who he was. And that's the point. If you can validate who your son is by simply paying attention to him as he is, without correcting, modifying, directing, just simply being with him where he's at. Now you'll find, if you try to do this, if you try to do special time with your son, you'll find that within 2 minutes of sitting down with him, your mind is going to wander. And it's not because you're inadequate. That's how we all experience this. It's a muscle that is way, way, way underused. We have to build that muscle up. We never had anybody do that for us. So we're not drawing on some experience bank. You know, we know how to do it. We're going to be fumbling our way along. Our minds are going to wander. Or worse, we're going to find ourselves telling our sons what we will and won't do. No, I'm not going to play video games. No, I don't want to do that. How about we do this? And your son's going to get the message that what he wants to do with this resource of time has to fit your very narrow comfort zone. You know, and that's the message he gets everywhere all the time. That it's his job to step up and be what somebody else wants him to be. And that's not the point of the exercise. He does that a lot of the time of the day. He's doing that all day here. Doing what teachers want, what coaches want. There should be some time in his life where he simply gets to be himself and somebody enjoys the hell out of him. And that's you guys. You, his parents, matter more than anything. Okay, virtue of sincerity. And it's just simply encouraging boys to give voice to what they feel. You don't want your sons, 15, 16, 18-year-old sons, to wind up like I was at 25 years old. I have this vivid memory of you know, I was in love with this woman. We had to leave. She had gone. I was sitting on a bench. I remember it really, really well. And I know I feel sad. I know I feel brokenhearted. But I'm numb. I can't find anything. In my head, I know I feel bad, but I can't find the feeling in my heart. I have no access to that part of me. And I'm a psychologist, for God's sakes. You know, this is my work. I can tell you the really, really encouraging news here. I lead a group of 17, 18-year-old boys, about 50 of them, that meets every other week at a school that I work in. And I run what we call a peer counseling program that's really practice time in emotional literacy. And I can tell you that your boys are right there. They're just waiting for the opportunity to express themselves. At 18, they haven't gone as far in the other direction as I had gone by 25. How do you help boys practice putting words to feelings and communicating those feelings to somebody else? Again, you're the best people. The role of parents as counselors for their children is the role I'm talking about right now. And it's a step beyond special time. It's actually recognizing that you're the counselor. Now, that doesn't mean you give your sons advice. It doesn't mean that you tell him what to think or what to do out of some anxiety that you feel about him about to make a wrong choice. And if you do that, if you use the time that he's feeling vulnerable to talk to you, if you use that time to simply dominate him and tell him what to think or what to do, he's going to stop coming to you. He's going to stop showing you where he's uncertain and vulnerable, because the last thing somebody wants when they're feeling vulnerable is for someone to tell them what to do. We have to solve our own problem within our own minds. I can't import what Ned does, even though we might have remarkably similar experiences, because I'm not Ned. Your son is not you. And your job is to empower his own confidence in solving life's problems. It's fine if he makes mistakes. It's fine if he fumbles and stumbles. It's actually fine. It's a life lesson. You know the blessing of the skinned knee? Your job is only to rescue your sons when something drastic might happen. Not when you feel like something's awry, but when actually something bad might happen. And the rest of the time, in this role of parents as counselors, your job is actually to create an open space, a welcoming space, what we psychologists call a holding environment. A place where your son feels held in your love, in your understanding, and in your willingness to listen. It's that simple. There's a wonderful book that just came out. It's titled Listen by Patty Whipler, and it's from the Hand in Hand Parenting Organization out in California. I recommend it. It's got a lot of really helpful ideas about how you actually go about listening. Okay, and the whole point of this is, you know, it's great. You'll get to know your son, you'll feel connected with your son, it has all those benefits. But in this context, what you're trying to do is you're strengthening your son's commitment to his own sincerity, because that'll make a world of difference for him in relationship all the rest of his life. So, we talk about gender as a body practice. It's gender, masculinity, is a way of thinking about who I am based upon my body. I'm different from you because we have different bodies. I'm a guy. I'm a male. And I learned that lesson early on. You know, there's this, there's that. And as I acquired a sense of what it meant to be a male, I related to my body based upon those ideas. And very quickly, I learned that guys, to be a guy, was to be strong, was to climb trees, was to play rough sports, was to train as an athlete so that I overcame pain and limitation. I pushed myself. I took one for the team. I learned to play through pain. In fact, I learned that that's how you train. I still do it to myself. I'm that guy that when I go biking, I like the hills the best. Why? Because they take me to the very edge of what I can do, and I suffer further. And it's actually a wonderful quality about being male that we can do this. It's a great thing. But it crosses a line when it results in our treating our bodies as a thing. And our attitude towards our bodies is simply to dominate our bodies, to use our bodies as a tool, an instrument. When we do that, when we numb ourselves to our physical being, we're learning a lesson about integrity, because we are fundamentally wired in a survival instinct way to preserve ourselves. And if masculinity is teaching us to trump that, excuse that word, it just comes out nowadays. I'm not in Czech politics mode. If masculinity teaches us to override our self-preservation instinct, then there's a lesson there about masculinity and a lesson about integrity. And that lesson about integrity carries far. So, what can parents do? Well, it's really simple. Take your son's physical complaints seriously. Don't poo-poo them. Don't say you're acting like a girl. Man up. Toughen up. Allow your sons to complain about that aching shoulder or whatever it might be, because in some ways the symptom that he's complaining about is much less important than the more fundamental lesson he's absorbing in his relationship with you about what happens when he's suffering, when he's voicing a concern. What we want to happen is we want your son to be met with sympathy, understanding, and patience. Tell me about it. Oh, I'm sorry you feel that way. Can I help you? You know, I think we tend to worry when we're all in the grips of this masculine ideology. We worry that our sons might become somehow weak, or soft, or sissies. And those concerns drive us. Let me tell you a story. A woman, Olga Silverstein, wrote a wonderful book, The Courage to Raise Good Men. The book was about, as a single mom, can I actually raise my son? And she told a story in that book about an experiment that happened in the doctor's waiting room. So we're in the doctor's waiting room, unbeknownst to the folks that are coming in to see the doctor, there's a camera in the corner. I think it's filming me right now, actually. And you. And the video camera's running, and there's a mother with a child dressed in white coming into the waiting room, sitting down among the other folks that are in the room. And alternately, when the nurse comes up and says, the doctor will see you now, the mother, who's got this infant dressed in white, turns to the other folks in the waiting room and says, would you mind holding my daughter? Would you mind holding my son? And she goes into the waiting room, into the doctor's office for a few minutes. The folks in the waiting room are holding this child. The video camera's running. And the experiment really was to analyze what happened when the child was identified as a female or male. When the child was identified as a female, will you hold my daughter? The child was held close, talked to, smiled at. When the child was identified as a male, within 30 seconds he's on the carpet playing with keys. That's the curriculum of masculinity at work. We carry those kinds of assumptions about what boys need, and our fears in particular about not spoiling their masculinity. We got to toughen them up. We can't protect them from life's bumps and bruises for fear that they won't be up to cope with. I'll tell you another story. This is a confession. You're going to be my confession. I lived in a fairly tough neighborhood in Philadelphia, and I had a son who was at the time 7 years old. And he was trying to get on with the other boys in the playground just down the street. And the boys, the gang of boys, the pack of boys, became hard on him, began to target him. I think there was ways he was different. And he would go down, they would be mean to him, he would come home, and this happened again and again and again. And each time it happened, I began to imagine my son's future. Oh my gosh, you know, I can't have a son that's an indoor boy because he's afraid or can't get on with the boys at the playground. So finally, one morning, I guess I was particularly, you know, frazzled or something. He goes off to the playground. I'm happy doing my thing. Within a very short time, I hear him opening the front door. I run out, meet him at the step. This is a row house neighborhood. And I say, you can't come in. I said, you can't come in. You actually have to go back down to that playground and you have to figure it out. And this whole interaction escalates to where he has this huge meltdown on my front step in front of the neighbors. You know, he's screaming and trying to get by me to reach the door. And I'm saying, you can't come in. I'm not going to let you come in. And I'm feeling like, oh my God, I'm traumatizing this boy. You know, what a heartless thing to do. But I'm taking a stand. And I realized afterwards, I'm not terribly wrong in my understanding of the fact that he needs to find some way to cope with this harsh aspect of his life as a boy. But I wasn't coming from that place, just. I was coming from an anxiety. I was imagining where my son might go, and I was afraid that he would be that boy that couldn't handle that harshness. And so I was communicating, nope, not my son. He's okay now, by the way. He's the guy that just had the other son, so we'll see how he treats us. You know, allowing our sons to be real about what's going on with their body. Another virtue, tremendously important, it actually came into play with my son in terms of that peer group that was bullying him in the playground. You know, brotherhood, being part of the gang, having friends to be part of, is hugely important for boys. You want to be with the guys. Because if you're not with the guys, sometimes there's bad consequences. Or you're that guy that gets scapegoated or targeted. But in a very instinctual way, you know, we're pack animals, tribal people. We want to be part of the tribe. We want to have a gang of friends. Nothing elevates a boy more, I think, than having a gang of buddies that he can be friends with. The problem is that brotherhood can sometimes be infected with ideas that are corrosive of boys' basic values. And what happens as boys try to fit in with that gang of brothers is they know that this is not who they are or what they want, but they become afraid of going against the group. You know, whether it's about using substances or treating women a certain way or using pornography or whatever it might be, you know, you don't want to be that guy that doesn't go along. And those compromises actually eat away at a boy's sense of self, who he really is. So, it's an exercise in courage every day to be a boy. There are moments every day where you get to and try to figure out, basically, how to stand for who you really are in the context of a group that's promoting values that you really don't subscribe to. And those lessons in submission to group norms are what we're talking about. So helping our sons, helping boys identify what matters to them, and helping them determine how important that is. To talk about the fear of what might happen if they take a stand there, what consequences might befall them. Just being, in some ways, their corner guy, the guy in the corner. I'm thinking of the Rocky movie. You know, what was that guy's name in the corner? Yeah. But, you know, we're those guys. They're going into battle. We're sending them off to round three. We're in the corner, and we're saying, yeah, you're getting beat up here, but you can do it, Rocky. You know, it matters that you are trying to be yourself. I know it's not easy. I know it's running a risk. But it's important that you figure out, that you find your courage. Similarly, going back to that whole idea of brotherhood and boys' clubs, one of the things that's promoted is a sense of kind of top dog, underdog, you know? You're in, you're not in. Othering. And the people who are not in the club, we make attributions about them that are derogatory, that are unfair. And same rule applies there, you know? We don't want our sons absorbing these messages as if they're true. Their fundamental sense of decency and fairness and justice that those empathic connections to everyone, that's who our sons are originally, and we want our sons to be able to hold on to those values. So, one of the topics that I address in this group with 17, 18-year-olds is sex, love, and affection. And, you know, you can imagine, it's a hot topic. Boys want to talk about it. And the truth, the research really is clear. Boys are, generally speaking, more vulnerable and less powerful in relationships, intimate relationships, than females. We need to be close. And we just don't have much experience that way. We come to those relationships desperate, discouraged, and sometimes dangerous. You know, the rates of sexual assault on college campuses are sobering. What kind of game do those guys have, actually, you know? What's going on there? What we want is our sons to believe that love matters. That it's, of course they feel love, of course they want love, of course they want closeness and intimacy, not random sex. Not sex that's powered by exposure to pornographic images. I did the topic of pornography with these guys, and I asked these guys, 50 of them in the room, how many of you use pornography? 50 guys raised their hands. The average age at which a boy is exposed to pornography is 12 years old. The average number of video images that boys see weekly, 50 images. I asked the boys, how does this affect you? And they said, it changes me. It changes how I think about girls, sex, myself, my body. You know, at a point in their development, when those neural connections are still very fluid, that kind of experience has an effect. What can counter that kind of dehumanization is parents who understand that love matters to our sons. It truly does matter. What they want more than anything else is to be close to somebody, to love somebody, and to experience being loved. And we get to be folks that stand for that. Don't settle for the cheap stuff. Go for the gusto. Go for the real thing. Go for the thing that really matters to you. And then lastly, the virtue of commitment. Historically, so you guys know this, I think that's probably why you sent your sons to a single-sex school for boys. Boys, there is a gender achievement gap that's been true for 100 years. From the time that boys and girls come into kindergarten, girls get better grades. Why do they get better grades? It's not because you're smarter, ladies. It's because you come to school and you're in it to win it. And we guys come to school with a set of attitudes that actually interfere with our applying ourselves wholeheartedly to the project. Masculinity actually interferes with boys trying hard, listening to the teacher, caring about the quality of their work. You know, what we call soft skills is what differentiates females from males as early as first grade. And then the problem is, what happens to that difference? Typically what happens in schools is that it grows. Teachers naturally prefer to interact with cooperative individuals, individuals who care about their work, and try. And we find that that gap grows from first grade to eighth grade. Boys fall further behind. So I was, the whole story of boys' education was important to me. I was consulting to the school, and I was asked to do a couple of global studies of boys' education, which I did do. And they resulted in this book that came out 2 years ago. But basically, to summarize the whole 5 years of my life and lots and lots and lots of research, what we found was that boys are relational learners. Contrary to stereotypes, contrary to common belief, for a boy, first base is a connection with a teacher or a coach. A boy is more willing to check out, to underachieve, I think, than girls. More fragile, less resilient. What they need in order to engage what we call the mediating variable in investing myself in an endeavor like education is I have to believe that you care about me, that it matters to you, and that you believe in me. And if I got that, if I got you in my corner, backing me, believing in me, helping me where I get stuck, if I can come to you with challenges and difficulties, then I'm going to try harder. And that elevating experience of a relationship is how boys get engaged in learning.